Welcome to The Platform, Season 2, a few changes. It's great to be here and thank you for your company. I'm Togsy, along with Warwick Kappa, co-host.
Fantastic to be here, Andrew. How are we looking? Good?
I think we're looking all right.
Just going to look at a monitor. It's going to be a great show.
Brian Canham, our first guest. How are you?
Andy, Warwick, I'm good, thank you.
Mate, are you a good sleeper?
Not bad, I reckon.
Get some
not
good bad. Sleeps? What about you, Warwick? You get some good sleeps?
Not the last 4 weeks. I've been a bit of a struggle. Why?
I found this thing on Facebook where, like, if you put a camera on someone and you put in this code and stuff, you can film them and it actually reads their thoughts.
Really?
And it was so fascinating what I shot. And I've actually got it to show, so let's have a look at it.
That could be interesting, Brian.
That sounds dangerous.
Let's have a casual glance.
Kappa, oh, that's Kappa again. Straight up the ground, that's the way to go. Kappa!
Hooks it back, Tony Morley. Oh, what a mark to Kappa!
Kappa at the back of the pack, flies.
Oh, thank golly. Back on the ground, that most of the daily interchanging with Kappa! But he's been not covering enough ground.
Here it is.
Kappa, Kappa!
Big chance here on Langford. Oh dear, oh what a mark!
You are a very happy sleeper.
Caps is very happy with himself. I had to pole vault to the toilet.
I knew you'd be dreaming fantastic. About yourself. That's not bad there. Now, Brian, mate, thanks for being on the show.
Pleasure.
But before we get to you, Larry Emder, who hosts a great show with The Morning Show, he did a great intro of you. So let's have a look at that to intro Brian.
They're the band who brought Aussies the unmistakable electropop sound of the 80s. Led by Brian Canham, Pseudo Echo were music pioneers, making their debut in 1984 with the smash hit Listening. These Melbourne boys went on to achieve more music chart success with a second album and platinum sales. Though it was 1986 when they truly struck a chord, taking us all the way to Funky Town with their cover of the lip sync classic. Won't you take me to a funky town? Won't you take me to a funky town? The hit earned them international recognition and album sales in excess of 1 million worldwide.
Larry, that was fantastic, I reckon.
That was a good job from Larry Emder. We love the morning show. Mate, welcome to the show officially.
Yeah, thank you.
What's been going on? What's been happening for you?
We're about to embark on about a 50-date tour around the country.
Wow.
With our friends in 1927. So been gearing up for that. That's been good. In the studio, out of the studio, back onto the road. So
and great. How does it feel when you see footage back from the glory days?
That's great. Great. You know, I
had more hair there, mate.
I had more hair.
less cut.
Same here.
Funny about that.
What was it like? I've been on Countdown, because I actually hosted Countdown 85.
Yeah.
The second last show. That was probably your biggest break, wasn't it?
Well, yeah, Countdown was like our second home. We spent so long doing that show. And I think that for us it was an amazing journey because we were launched, our first song on there, and basically our whole career was during the airing of Countdown.
Wow.
Great platform.
So how did it all start? Like, I mean, your family had a business with cabinet making and you were going to be a cabinet maker. And how did music come into it?
And a family of footballers too,
wow.
Strangely enough.
Yeah. Do these do some key yappers in the backyard?
One of us was the black sheep.
You're a muse.
Yeah, well, when we started, we were just gigging around little city venues.
Yeah.
And somebody, a mutual friend of Molly's, tipped him off and said, you've got to go and see this band. So fortunately, when he did come and see us, we were going okay then. We were headlining shows and we had a good crowd and Molly came along to the show and we saw the hat in the crowd and we thought, oh God, here we go. So we just tried to concentrate on the gig. And then when we went backstage, Molly came back with a little entourage and, you know, said hello and introduced himself. And he got our manager's number and called him a couple of days later and just said, I want to put the boys on Countdown. So it was a bit of a surprise to us because there was a policy at the time where you couldn't really go on Countdown without a record deal.
Right.
Yeah. And so I think they bent a few rules and they did a bit of moonlighting after hours and got us in the studio. And then Moll gave us a big spiel, and you know, the rest is history, as I say.
Well, you guys had such a unique sound for Australia, and I guess at that time when you're in Melbourne, it would have been a real pub and rock, hard band, rock.
Yeah. It very much was. So,
and you started off three-piece, didn't you?
That's
right. And your keyboards.
Yeah, we were just a guitar band when I started with Pierre, my friend from high school.
Yep.
And we were always just looking for the other members to fill the band out. And when we started Pseudos, we just had we met a keyboard player. And once I'd heard, you know, the sounds coming out of this thing, I said, right, this is our sound. So it quickly became dominant as part of the sound. And then we brought in a drummer who I'd known from a few years back, Anthony Argiro. And Anthony, we put him on those electronic drums, which we had to buy from the UK because they didn't have them in Australia. So,
wow.
How'd you think of the name Pseudo? Echo. Not Pseudo Ephedrine.
That's right. not to be confused with any pharmaceutical
products. Sudafed, Pseudo, yeah.
The name, strangely...
It's a good name, isn't it?
Yeah. It is a good name. I think it's a good name. We couldn't pronounce it properly for a while, but at least we can now. But one of our guys in the band was reading his manual on his synthesizer that he newly acquired.
Yep.
And they had little names for each sound, and one of them was Pseudo Echo Machine.
Wow.
So he just happened to be reading that out while we were tossing names around.
Awesome. And when you're writing and creating the songs, what comes first? Do you get an idea for the lyrics or do you feel the sound in your mind first?
Yeah, for me, pretty much the sound. I would go
beat, yep.
Bass synth, bit of keyboards. I'd muck around with some sounds, find a sound, find a riff.
Then a chorus and lyrics.
That's it.
Yep.
He's got it down.
He should know.
He's an old hand.
He's had number one song myself. Can't Take What's Mine, 1985. And you know
speaking,
that, Brian?
I know.
Speaking of that track, let's have a look at a little bit of listening. We've got it for it to
We
play.
Love listening.
Great memories. Nice red guitar.
I used to sing out the shower. Because Mum used to go, "Aren't you listening, Warwick?" I said, "I am listening to Brian."
Well, I'm flattered.
So, Brian, with your music as well, like you produce a lot of other artists as well, right?
Yeah, I did over the course of about 10 years or so.
Name some of those, because I've heard them on the radio before.
Chocolate Starfish, Shantuzies, did a few mixes for Taxi Ride.
Classic.
I even did a remix for Lee Kernaghan.
Yeah, I actually had Lee Kernaghan come to my wife's birthday. He's unreal.
Who's one artist you'd love to actually do something for?
Tame Impala.
Yeah?
I love Tame Impala.
Nice. All right, well, we're going to take a break. More with Brian Canham when we come back. Thanks for watching The Platform.